goosebumps every.
Now head to the dispensaries, you bastards.
Time, I need the Heimlich. Throw that to the side.
Reviewer beware, my name is Josh Irby. Welcome back. Everyone take a seat. In fact, plant it. This next book is about to grow on you, and we're about to get the root of it soon. If it sounds like I'm making a bunch of dad jokes, I'm sorry. I'm a dad at heart. But with this book, what you're about to find out is a family that has more daddy issues than the woman who becomes a future Karen and tells the manager at Buffalo Wild Wings how much their service is garbage. But I'm really excited to review this book. Remember how I mentioned how Welcome to Deadhouse was paced a little bit slow and it's a good foundational book? I think what we have here today is the first book that represents a truly tight Goosebumps classic. This is Goosebumps Number 2, Stay Out of the Basement. Go green. So, if it looks like I have a different cover than the classic hand that's presented here, that's because this book, as well as another book that we will get to later, I will signify that when the time comes, this is the cover that was done by Tim Jacobus. The original cover, by the artist of all but two of the original series, did not make the deadline for the original Stay Out of the Basement, and to be honest, this cover, eh. But the original cover is just a classic with the green hand, the leaves coming out. You might have actually noticed us try something with the intro with it.
Viewer beware, you're in for a scare.
Because it's honestly a phenomenal cover. It is so simplistic, but it gets the point home. Speaking of home, we go back to another book that starts out at home, but not a home where we have to find out that they kill the dog this time. Ah! How it begins is at the Brewer residence, and Margaret and Casey are dealing with the fact that suddenly their dad, who is a botanist, who presumably and supposedly got fired from his job at Polytech, is at home doing strange experiments in the basement. And something interests me about this intro is it almost dives into a specific type of family dynamic. Not every parent is open and affectionate. Some parents seem so cold. And that's what Margaret and her brother Casey are worried about. Normally, Margaret is happy when her dad calls her Princess, or jokingly nicknames her Fatso, even though she is a thin 12-year-old. But suddenly, he is acting cold. And he keeps going downstairs to the basement to work on his science experiments, do his work with plants. Okay. So, I guess weed was real in 1992.
Dad, look, it's the good Kush.
This is the dollar store. How good can it be?
Great. Now head to the dispensaries, you bastards. Margaret and Casey eventually grow suspicious, and they wonder themselves, what's going on in the basement? And so they go downstairs to the basement for the first time, and we get to hear their dad say the iconic line at the end of the first chapter. Take it away, Mr. Brewer! Then the story goes to
2 weeks later.
Mrs. Brewer leaves the house to go visit her sick aunt and leaves Casey and Margaret with their dad, who is still cold towards them. Although, if Arlstein's implying what I think he is, he's not cold, he's just baked. We got nothing to worry about. Puff puff, homies. Them and Margaret's friend Diane return to the basement. And this introduces one of Arlstein's unfortunate, most annoying traits. Bringing in a side character that is not needed to progress the plot forward. he decides we don't have enough characters, so you know what? We're just gonna bring in another one. So all of them return to the basement, and we get the beginning of what is one of the best aspects to Stay Out of the Basement. The descriptiveness of the plants. They're breathing. They're almost lifelike. You could probably hear a heartbeat out of those things. But anyways, as expected, they get caught a second time by their father. Things actually get worse later on. Margaret tries to call her mother, still worried about the father. And then she sees something really gross. He's eating plant food.
Everyone here, please listen. We want your attention for just one moment.
A vegetarian? How dare you hurt my virgin Taco Bell eating soul, Arl Stein! You already killed a dog!
We have a challenge for you today. We just asked the hostess if there was any dog meat here. And she said no, there wasn't. How could anyone kill a dog? We love animals. We all love animals.
You're a goddamn moron.
We even have another scenery where Diane and Margaret are playing Frisbee. And because they're athletically inclined as me when I pretend to play defense on the basketball court, they hit their dad's head, knock it off, and suddenly plants are growing out of his head. I really hope this book ends with him becoming Mega Venusaur. Wouldn't that be sick? Maybe then he'd be able to give Ash a Pokemon that's actually good. So, we already have two scares that, in theory, don't seem like they'd be harmless. But think about the creepy aspects. Your father is growing essentially a garden in his head, and he's just devouring plant food. He's like Mega Popeye. So why is all this happening? To be honest, Arl Stein ties this up with an actual explanation of Dr. Brewer's plan is he's essentially gonna make human life and DNA intelligence out of these plants. Why they breathe, why it seems like they move, why it seems like they're so lifelike. It's all part of his experiment. He does apologize to the two kids for being so cold towards them because they don't like weed. It gets worse, and to be honest, this next scene is where this book's starting to make my stomach turn a little bit. Margaret is seeing her dad washing his hands in the sink. But why is he bleeding green? Mary Jane. She tries to ask her dad about it and opens up the bed. All we see is dirt and earthworms. It's probably gonna be my future marriage. The next day, it gets even more disgusting. Their dad essentially tries to feed them these disgusting green food substances. He's trying to force it down, and it's not even like, oh, you might enjoy this. Enjoy this exotic food. It might be crap, but we're gonna try anyway. No. He is essentially eat.
If you don't eat your meat, you can't have any pudding.
It better be done when I get back.
If you don't eat your meat, you can't have any pudding.
So before Margaret and Casey have to eat it down, they are saved by the bell.
When I wake up in the morning and the alarm gets out of warning, I don't think I'll ever make it on time. By the time I grab my books and I give myself a look, I'm at the corner just in time to see the bus fly by. It's alright, cause I'm saved by the bell.
By bell, I mean the doorbell. And who comes in? Mr. Martinez, an old partner of Dr. Brewer, who also worked with him in the lab. They have just enough time to wash the food away and not eat it. And to be honest, we'll get to poisoned food. It might be 5, 10, 15, 48 books later, but we'll get there. So why is Mr. Martinez there? Because he wants to see his father's work. And you know what? I have a book in my hands, and I'm going to read some of the pages that Alex Dollarshell...
Ooh, got that drip. Got that drip.
Bro, you ugly. Dude, you actually look gay.
I feel like...
You look like a cotton candy...
I feel like I'm in 2003.
Looks like a cotton candy nightmare.
2003, bro. I got the cuff shirt.
Hold
up.
Hold up. Your outfit costs $187.
That's
drip. How much are the glasses?
AKA the guy who got his ass whooped by my Falcon Punch, described as some eroticism. You know, we got things such as long brown tendrils snaked along the dirt, wrapping themselves around other plants, around each other. A bushy fern has grown to the ceiling, curved, and started its way back down. Gross! See what I mean about the descriptions? And how deep they can get into it. When R.L. Stein wants to, he can be so imaginative. And he can kill dogs!
Hey everyone, listen! The talking dog at the Shell Shack is singing! Come on!
The next day, things seem even worse. Because Casey and Margaret find Dr. Martinez's clothes when they go back down to the basement again. Let's see, we got man's clothes, closets.
Ha! Gay!
No, it's 2020. I don't really want to be put on blast, but it's just something to think about if you get my drift. I'll be subtle about it, but you know. You know when you know. Brokeback Mountain. They go back into the basement and they find plants with human faces. I'm not gonna attempt to describe them. So in the closet, they find their dad tied up. They find Mr. Martinez, and that's the end. I'm kidding. That is not the end. But how is it that they're both tied up in the closet? I thought we saw their plant dad. Their plant dad, in fact, was away getting their mom. Why do I say that? Because in the next scene, we have a dilemma. Two versions of Dr. Brewer are in the basement, and Margaret is left with a dilemma here. She has to choose to attack one. One of them is a weed monster. I mean plant. I totally meant weed monster. and one of them is her actual father. So she stabs at one of them, draws real blood, and then we get axe murder.
Little pigs, let me come in. Not by the hair on your chinny chin chin. Then I'll huff, and I'll puff, and I'll blow your house in.
Not kidding, we get axe murder.
And I'll blow your house in.
The plant brewer is killed by Margaret, essentially raising an axe. I love this book. We have dirt, worms, human plants. Axe murder!
And I'll blow your house in.
And this is a book that catches you off guard even more so than Dead House because it's just plants. I expect nothing from it. The one opportunity that I wish they would have taken a little differently after all this is with the twist. What is the twist? Well, everything seems all right. Dr. Brewer destroys all his plants. We find out that the reason why there was a plant dad is because Dr. Brewer, while doing his experiments, accidentally cut himself and the blood mixed in with the green. And he became plant dad. The reason I say a missed opportunity with the twist is, first off, this twist isn't bad. Essentially, Margaret goes back to the garden. A bunch of flowers are saying, I'm your father, I'm your father, I'm your father. Here's what I would do with the twist. Have it so either Margaret or Casey's blood got mixed in. This cycle all begins again with Plant Kid. But that's just something I would change. This is legitimately a outstanding book. R.L. Stine's descriptiveness and imagination shines through. It's paced a lot better than Dead House. It gets going. It builds itself a lot more instead of slow first act, slow second act. Oh, everything good. No, it takes its time. It builds up to something really creepy and progressive. This book is absolutely bumping. I highly recommend it. And you know what? We're on the green theme enough. We're done with pot jokes. Next up, we're going to find out what happens if the walls ooze green slime scene came to life. We are reviewing one of a four-part series, the very original Goosebumps Number 3, Monster Blood. Till next time, reviewer beware, Colin did not ruin this review this time.
I still could if I wanted to.
What the? If you liked today's video, please feel free to like, comment, subscribe to Reviewer Beware, share the word. We got 60 more books to go after this, and I want you to be a part of all of them. And we have Clown Mask. Who else can say they have clown mask?